Welcome back to your free Windows 7 training course. In this video, I will look at application control policies, otherwise known as AppLocker. This is a new feature in Windows 7. It has more features than software restrictions that I looked at in the last video. Unfortunately, it cannot be used as a replacement due to it only being available in the Enterprise and Ultimate editions of Windows 7. AppLocker can not only secure the software currently running on the computer, but also new versions of that software when they come out. For example, if you apply a new service pack to a computer and it updates all the games on the computer, you will not have to create a new rule for the new version of the games. When the software is run, AppLocker will be able to work out that it is looking at new versions of the software. To better understand the difference between AppLocker and software restriction policies, consider this table. This table shows the main differences between the two. First, the rules scope is different. Software restriction policy only applies at the computer level. With software restriction policies, you could set options to determine if the administrator is affected, but you did not have the granular control over which user was affected. With AppLocker, you can apply a particular rule down to a group and even a particular user. You could, for example, allow the marketing department access to an application, but deny access to the sales department. The next change is the rule types. AppLocker supports three types of rules. These are hash, path, and publisher. There is no longer support for zones rules, but you will find that these three rules should cover most scenarios. The big change with AppLocker is that it has wizards where software restriction policy does not. This makes it easier to configure than software restriction policy. Next, you have additional features such as PowerShell support and custom error message. These two features allow you to take more control over AppLocker and customize it the way you want. AppLocker relies on a service called the Application Identity Service. By default, this service is set to manual. When testing out AppLocker, I would recommend making your changes and then starting the service. If you find that there are problems with AppLocker, you can simply stop the service. Once you are happy with the changes, change the service to start automatically. If you are supporting an enterprise and want to set this service to start automatically, you need to configure the following group policy setting. However, this group policy is only available in a domain group policy. It is not available in local group policy. To see how to configure this policy, I will switch to my Windows Server 2008 R2 server in the domain. From the Start menu, run Group Policy Management. To show you the setting, I will edit the default domain policy rather than creating a new policy. The setting is found under Computer Configuration, Policies, Windows Settings, Security Settings, and finally, System Services. To change the Application Identity Service startup type, select it and select Define this policy setting. From here, I can set what startup mode I want. In this case, I will select Automatic, so the service will start up automatically when the computer starts up. Now that the group policy setting is set, I can switch back to my Windows 7 computer to configure AppLocker. To configure AppLocker on this computer, I will go to the Start menu and edit the local group policy. The settings that I am configuring now, I could have configured in the default domain policy on my Windows Server 2008 R2 computer. The settings for AppLocker are found under Computer Settings, Windows Settings, Security Settings, Application Control Policies, and finally, AppLocker. These settings are not available in the User section for Group Policy, but as you will see, you can configure to which users the settings will apply. First, I will set the global options by selecting Configure Rule Enforcement. When I select the tick box configured at the top, I can set the default action for executable rules. There are only two rules here, and the default setting is enforce rules. So the only thing that you achieve by configuring this rule is setting it to audit mode. Audit mode will allow all software to run normally. If you run software that would have been blocked by a rule, this will be logged in the event log. This option allows you to gather information about what effects the changes in rules will have. If you are not sure what software needs to be blocked, you can always block all software and select audit mode. Once you start getting some details about what software is being run on the computer, you can make a more informed decision on which rules you should be creating. The same option also exists for Windows installer rules and script rules. If you want to create a new rule, for example, to create a new executable rule, you can exit the global options and then right-click Executable Rules and select Create New Rule. However, if you have a lot of software, this can be time-consuming to set up. The second option, Automatically Generate Rules, will go through and find all the programs it can and create relevant rules for them. When I select Automatically Generate Rules, it will default to the program files directory, the place most likely your programs will be. Once I have selected the directory, I will be asked what type of rule I want to create. By default, it will create publisher rules for files that are digitally signed. If you select this option, you can also select to use hash rule or a path rule. The hash rule will put the file through an algorithm and generate a number. This means the file can be renamed or moved and the rule will still work. The path rule works by using the path of the file. If the file is moved or renamed, the path rule will stop working. If you have software that is not digitally signed, select the last option, Create File Hash Rules for All Files. Nowadays, most operating system and third-party software is digitally signed. I would recommend leaving the option Reduce the Number of Rules Created by Grouping Similar Files on. Where possible, the wizard will reduce the number of rules required. If you untick this option, you will have more rules to manage. Once I press Next, the directory will be examined and the rules are created. Once complete, I can select the option Review Files that were analyzed. All the files are in here. For example, here's the rule for Windows Media Player. Notice that there are a lot of files it found that are part of Windows Media Player. If I go back and select the option View Rules that will be automatically created, there are only two rules that will be created. There were 44 files that were analyzed and broken down into two rules. This is a lot easier to manage than 44 rules. Once I go back and select the option Create, the rules will be created. Notice I get a dialog box asking me if I want to create some default rules. By default, AppLocker rules will block any applications that it does not have a rule for. If I create some default rules, this will ensure that all applications will run unless I say otherwise. Here you can see the three default rules that were created. These allow applications to be run from the program files directory and also for any user in the administrators group. Now that the rules have been created, I will create a new rule to block an application. Once I start the wizard and go past the welcome screen, I will get to the option to select the rule to either allow or deny. In this case, deny. Notice that this is where you can set which users the rule will affect. If you only want to target a group of users or a particular user, you can set it here. On the next screen, you can again set the type of rule, publisher, path, or file hash. In this case, I will leave it on publisher. On the next screen, I can select which executable I want to block. In this case, I will browse to the program files directory and select solitaire. Once selected, I can move the slide bar up and down to change the rule scope. At the top, you can choose Publisher, which will match all files of the same publisher, in this case, Microsoft. As I go down, the rule becomes more specific, even down to the version number. On the next screen, you can enter an exception. For example, you may want to block all files from a certain publisher, except software that has been approved to be run. Lastly, you get to enter in a name and description for the newly created rule. You will notice that if I now go to the Start menu and run Solitaire, Solitaire still runs without a problem, even though I denied it. The problem is that the default domain policy has not refreshed to the local computer, and thus the service application identity is not running. If I want to run AppLocker before then, I can go into the Start menu and go into Services and manually start up Application Identity Service. If I now go back and attempt to run Solitaire, this time I will get a message saying that this program has been blocked by group policy. Once you know how to configure executable rules, you can also create rules for Windows Installer and scripts. The process is the same. That's it for applications restrictions. In the next video, I will look at Internet Explorer.